Praise the Lord. We thank the Lord for another beautiful day, a glorious time and moment with God. The Lord has been gracious to us. The Lord has been faithful and merciful. The Bible says that the Lord will be gracious unto us morning by morning. So today, He's been gracious to us. His grace abounds and super abound. Now, I want us to look at our text. Today, we are looking at a part two of God in politics. God in politics. So let me read the text quickly. So Isaiah 33 verse 22 says, "For the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. And he will save us." We looked at part one of God in politics. And we said that because God is the originator of all things except sin, then God originated politics. We also look at the definitions of politics. Came from the Greek, which is politika, which are to do with affairs of the city, or affairs of the city, or affairs of the people. And we are all somewhere, somehow connected when it comes to the affairs of a city, a community, a people group. We are all connected, or we are all participate in one way or the other, which automatically makes us politicians. So anytime you're accusing a politician, remember that you are also a politician. Anytime you say things against politician, I want you to know that you are saying it against yourself. When you have understanding and you know you're a politician, you know that you are not dealing with some politician somewhere. I also came up with a definition of politics. So let me read that. As a politics, as far as I'm concerned, is a privileged portfolio to serve as a steward, holding in trust over resources by faithfully or equitably distributing of the same to the true owners. So in other words, in politics, every politician is serving. Every politician is a steward. Whatever we have, whatever we are placed on, whatever portfolio we hold, it's only a privilege. It's only a privilege. It's only a privilege position. And we are holding it and holding the things which are resources, statuses, which are given to us in trust, even to distribute back to the real owners or the original owners. The people are the original owners. We politicians are only servants and stewards called to serve faithfully or equitably, and we must respect the true owners of that. We also look at forms of politics, from the family, through the media, business and economy, media and communication, and all the various aspects of the eight societal gates or eight societal portals that we find politics in everything. Even in sibling relationships, there are politics there. Even in recording this message from this studio, there's politics that goes on. Because somebody influenced the programming, somebody influenced the videoing, somebody influenced the editing, somebody influenced almost everything that is done. So we need to understand that politics is everywhere in our lives and we are in it. We look at two important principles, and today we are going to look at the third to the eighth principles as far as politics is concerned before we end the part two. So we are in part two, God in politics. So number three, God's word is the divine manual that sheds light on politics. God's word is the divine manual that sheds light on politics. In John chapter 1, verse 1 to 5, I call the book of John as the Genesis of the New Testament. John chapter 1, I call it the Genesis of the New Testament, which also began by saying, "In the beginning, the Word was God. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning, the Word was with God. And the Word is God. There was nothing that is done without the Word being part of that which is done." By faith, we understand that God framed everything we see around us by the word of God, by the rhema of God. Hebrews 11 verses 3. So God's word sheds light. God's word is the manual, the divine manual that sheds light on politics. In other words, nobody can be effective in politics when you are not connecting to God's word. So in Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 18 to 20, we saw that when God told them, when they have come into the land that floweth with milk and honey, and they desire to have a leader over them, it says that a leader must do A, B, C, D. And one of the things God clearly stated, that they must actually let the leader copy from the law for himself. He himself will take and copy for himself and keep the copy of the laws of God, the commandments of God, that he will live by it and watch over it and let the word of the Lord govern his life. So the word of the Lord is our divine manual that sheds light on politics. We can't do without a word. Nobody can do politics without a word. Number four, God's design for politics is to reflect himself. God's design for politics is to reflect himself. When God made man in the book of Genesis, say, let us create man in our image. Let us create man after our likeness. God placed man, Adam, in charge, even to have a political influence over what he has created. But God said that man will reflect our glory, the man will reflect our image. So God's design for politics is that it will reflect himself. So anything we do in politics must reflect God. Whether it is in governmental policy, politics, whether it is family politics, whether it is religious politics, whatever level of politics, God must be reflected. God must be reflected. Politics that deflect and reject God is only politics. Politics that deflect or reject God is only politics. We need to understand that. So the Bible says God is our judge, our judiciary. God is our legislature, is our lawgiver. And God is our king, who is our executive. God is in politics. Everything must reflect him. Our judiciary must reflect God. Our legislature, which has to do with the Senate or the Parliament, should reflect God. The things we do, the laws we give, the laws we promulgate, the laws we put together, the interpretations, the executive, by executing all the things that are meant to execute, must reflect God. Very important. Number five, God's politics is ultimately to save his people, not to enslave. Politics that does not save is not a politics of God. God's politics ultimately saves people. Politics is not meant to enslave. How can people give you power? How can people vote for you? How can people place you as a steward over themselves and their resources? And you think you can use the same power to enslave the people? That's a failure. Any leader or any person at any level who uses the power the people has given him or her to enslave the people does not understand what true politics or God's politics is. He said, God is our judge. God is our lawgiver. God is our king. He will save us. So salvation is the ultimate purpose for politics. It means freedom. It means to bring help or give succor. It means to rescue. It means to defend, avenge. It means to preserve. It means to make people safe, or the economy safe, or the land safe. It means a savior, or it means to get victory. Any politics that is not reflecting this level of freedom or salvation, the person, the people, the groups have failed in politics. Politics ultimately, as far as God is concerned, is to bring salvation to the people. So if you are thinking of going to governmental politics, national politics, one of the things you need to prepare your heart for, that God must use you to bring salvation to the people and not to enslave the people. To bring empowerment and not to deny the people of their own resources. To bring rescue and not to drown the people. Number six, God's political system is what I call theodemocracy. Theodemocracy. God's political system is what I call theodemocracy. It means God ruling through mankind. in Genesis 1:26-31. Genesis 1:26-31, when God created Adam, he placed Adam as the politician for the earth, for creation. And God was ruling through Adam over his creation. So there was what we call the leadership or the governance that is absolutely held by God, or power that is held by God. And then also power from God through the people. So Theo is God. Democracy. So democracy. So I call it theodemocracy. That is power by God from God through the people to influence creation. In Hebrews 11:12, we'll understand this clearly. That the original plan of God hasn't changed. God made Adam to be a politician to rule. The devil came, brought sin to thwart what God has put together. But God's original plan has not changed. God's original plan has not changed. God rules in affairs of men with men. That is my quote. In theodemocracy, God rules in affairs of men with men or by men, for men. So God rules in affairs of men with men, by men, and for men to his glory. Leaders are established by God through the people. Leaders are established by God through the people. Some people believe that once we are voting for people, then God is not part of it. God is part of it. The Bible says in Proverbs 16:33 of the Amplified Version, Proverbs 16:33, it said, a lot is cast into the lap. The decision is wholly of the Lord. So the events that seem accidental are really ordered by God. So we need to understand that whether we vote for people or God elect people directly, it is all part of it. God is in it, and we must respect God for that. Number 7, God has ultimate power in politics. We need to understand that. God is the one who wields ultimate power in politics. In Daniel 2:19-22, but verse 21 in particular, Daniel told Nebuchadnezzar that God is the one who installs and establishes kings, and is the same one that removed them. So Daniel was saying to Nebuchadnezzar, by extension and effect, that the ultimate power in politics rests with God. We need to understand that. That is why we see today, some few years back, Donald Trump was the president of America. Today, Joe Biden is the president-elect of America, to show that no human being, no politician, no one has ultimate power when it comes to the issue of politics. In 2 Chronicles 20:6, the same thing happened. The people acknowledge God to be the one who has ultimate power. Finally, number 8, God's politics gives God pleasure. God's politics must give God pleasure. What it means is that in all politics, we need to understand that we serve the people under God to bring pleasure to God. Revelation 4:11, the Bible says, God created and made all things. For his pleasure he created us, and for his pleasure we do exist. So we must give God pleasure as politicians at every level of our lives. In conclusion, godless politics is a game of chance. So those who play politics without God, they are in lottery. They are not too sure. So it's a game of chance. Godless politics is a satanic politics. So politics without God is satanic, is demonic, is evil. Politics is godly and good, but men have twisted it. So politics is godly. Politics is good, but men have twisted it. Sometimes I hear people say, oh, politics is bad. Politics is evil. Politics is not good. Politics is an evil game. It's a lie. Politics is good. Politics is godly. But we human beings have twisted things and changed things. If we follow God's politics, then politics is godly and good. When godly men avoid politics, they create a free zone for the wicked. When godly men avoid politics, they create a free zone for wicked men to rule. And remember, when the wicked rule, the people will have troubles and sigh. But when the righteous rule in politics, then the people will rejoice. Finally, politics become dirty when men change the game plan. Politics is only dirty when we change the game plan. So as I conclude, I want to encourage all of us to go back to original game plan of politics as God ordained it. And we shall see politics as beautiful. Politics as beautiful and not dirty as people have confessed. God bless you. I'll come your way again with a message on God's standard for politicians. God's standards for politicians. Please don't miss this series and your life will never be the same again. God bless you. Mega shalom. And you will be blessed. Amen.